Welcome to this special webinar presented by the College Music Society. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to open today's presentation and workshop, Making the Cut in Academic Job Searches, developed by the CMS Committee on Career Development and Entrepreneurship. I'm delighted to see that we have over 150 colleagues registered for today's session, coming to us from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Before we begin, I want to offer special thanks to colleagues Nancy Berry and Michael Miller, co-chairs of the CMS Committee on Career Development and Entrepreneurship. Michael and Nancy have led the work that brings us here today, and all of us at CMS are grateful to them for their dedication. We're also very fortunate that they have lined up such an eminent panel for today. Dr. Berry will also serve as the moderator for this webinar. She is a longtime leader in the College Music Society, including many years of service as chair of the Academic Careers Committee, former secretary of the Society, and a champion for students and new colleagues. Dr. Berry comes to us from Auburn, Alabama, where she serves as professor of music education in the Department of Curriculum and Teaching at Auburn University. Nancy, welcome to this CMS webinar.
Thank you, Bill. And it's a pleasure to have this opportunity to share this information. And I'm so delighted to have this wonderful panel of colleagues to share their information. Bill has already introduced us, so a special thanks to my colleague and co-chair, Dr. Michael Miller, for all of his wonderful efforts in leadership and pulling things together. And we really want this to be very interactive, so our initial comments from the panel will be relatively brief, and we want to have the largest part of the time of this webinar invested in interaction and addressing questions from our participants. So we'll begin with the dean's perspective, and I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Lawrence Kapton, Dean of the College of Arts and Media at the University of Colorado, Denver. So Dr. Kapton, if you'll share your, as from the perspective of an administrator and a dean, your tips for successful interviews. Thank you, Dr. Kapton.
Great. Thanks so much, Nancy. Yeah, again, thanks to Nancy, Michael, Bill for inviting me to be on this panel. And this is something that we're all interested in, and that is finding ways to present ourselves in the best way for jobs. Okay. This worked a little bit. There we go. Okay. The three things that I want to try to cover today, and if this is from the dean's perspective, usually the dean is at the end of the interview process. And so time is usually short, and you're going to have, you know, 20 minutes, 30 minutes to make your case. And so I want to talk about how you can be effective being concise, distinctive, and inspiring. Okay, so the five areas I'm going to cover very quickly are all listed there, okay? And I'm going to go over each of these five individually very quickly. It's really important to be detail-oriented, of course, but you really need to have the big picture. Most search committees are going to cover a broad range of different areas, and even outside of the unit you might be interviewing for, being able to cite the mission, vision, values of the institution, and how your own personal brand and sense of self can align with that job. That's very important. Thinking in threes, I highly recommend this. And I got to tell you, in interviews I've had, you know, I've used the threes a lot. I mean, you can almost look at these quotes up here and name who these folks are, but these are all groups of threes by people like Martin Luther King Jr., Franklin Roosevelt, former President Obama, and so on. So again, three reasons for my interest, because the first question is usually, why are you interested in this position? Three reasons why this is a compelling position, and three reasons for anything else. Finding the sweet spot, I highly recommend copying all the data from the institution, making a word cloud out of it, and then making a list of what words are repeated over and over again. It's really interesting how lots of times they'll say, well, we're a student-centered institution, but the word faculty will be used 80 times, the word student 10 times and such. So by you looking at the frequency of word use, you can adapt how you're going to enter into the situation there. Also too, I think the research that sociologists are doing, like Stephen Tepper, Elizabeth Long Lingo, Alexander Fournette, Rachel Skaggs, Jennifer Novak Leonard, would be very, very valuable because they're all futurists who are basing future jobs on research that they've conducted. Beware of pronouns, okay? This can really be an interesting area. And using I a lot in your letter or in your speaking may be off-putting to some. One thing I highly recommend, it's not an ambush, but some places where you interview right away, they'll say the first question is, and I think if you want to set yourself up, you want to ask in advance to make a few comments if you want to set the stage, but also to request in advance that you have time at the end. Okay. That's really important. So, the other thing too, that I recommend is not to have a can of Mountain Dew to drink from, especially if you're on a screen, but to have a regular glass full of water. That can do a couple of things. If you need some more time to think, you can take a sip of the water and be thinking about a question that you need to process and answer there. I always take a glass with me whenever I've interviewed, just to have that there. Again, be very careful in the music field of choosing between band and orchestra, ensembles and academics, choir and opera, performance and music education. Lots of times those will come up, and you've got to be able to handle those judiciously. Folks will ask you about technology a lot. For inclusion and diversity, try to provide examples of your own work and work that you've led somewhere that, again, provides a foundation or a background for you to be considered on that basis. Enrollment management, recruiting, retention, and be careful with the NASM requirements, because those are embedded, they're foundational in a lot of institutions, but in some places they're not so embedded. So again, that can be something you want to be careful of. I would really recommend downloading this SNAP casebook, the Strategic National Arts Alumni Project. They've interviewed 200,000 arts graduates. I think musicians are in the majority, and lots of information there that you can quote and not only seem knowledgeable, but be knowledgeable in your interview with the committee or with the dean. Nancy?
Welcome. Thank you so much, Dr. Captain, and incredibly important information. Our next panelist is Dr. Isrea Butler. He is a very distinguished, internationally known performer, scholar, administrator, and he currently is serving as the chair of our department head at Valdosta State University. So he will provide us the department chair's perspective on the interview process. Dr. Butler.
Thank you. I don't know if I can live up to all of those titles you just gave me, but I am a trombone player and I am a department head, scholar perhaps. So the process here is a little bit different than what I've experienced in other places, because I've obviously been a search committee member and chaired search committees. But I did make some notes that I'd like to cover briefly. One of the biggest components of the whole process for someone wanting to become an assistant professor or whatever in academia is communication. All those communications, whether verbal or written, are extremely crucial in how you're perceived from the organization of your CV to your cover letter to just responding to emails about being invited to a Zoom or a phone interview to your setting up things like being picked up from the hotel and going to dinner. You're never not being interviewed. So if you think about that, I think that'll serve you well. So think that, you know, from the time you get your first email, you're being interviewed with how you respond. Get help with your cover and your CV. I had some great mentors that, you know, I was applying and not getting invited sometimes. So I started thinking, well, you know, what can I do better? Why am I not getting invited? So I sent it to some friends and they're like, well, because, you know, your cover letter is not great, or your CV is not organized well, or your CV has all this performance stuff, but this is an administrative position. So you need to focus on that and really show your success in that. Many, many revisions are needed for your CV and your cover letter. References are crucial. And also the people that are not listed. So make sure you have a great relationship with your coworkers, because they could be called even though they're not not listed. Dean Captain made a good point about technology, and I can speak to this because I've had this happen, not often, but I had a PowerPoint presentation that I was going to do, and I opened it up and it was the first page of the PowerPoint, and then I clicked the second page and there was nothing. So know your PowerPoint, know your presentation, be able to improvise it, or really know the material in case you have a technology failure. Mock interviews. I had a friend that was going up for some jobs, and it was kind of, you know, during the pandemic era, so they hadn't taken a lot of interviews at the time. So we set up some mock interviews, and I sat there and conducted an interview like I would if I were hiring someone. So have some friends, or people younger or older, and have them give you a mock interview process. So from the chair or head's perspective, we don't rate or pick the candidates that come. Once they're submitted to us, then they're invited, and we get to see them perform the recital. We get an hour with them. We may have dinner with them in the committee, but it's the committee's job to provide us a report. And then that's when we decide, you know, which candidate, you know, we're gonna go with. And that's a process that is not just the chair, but is also the input from the dean and the provost. Either of them can trump your decision. So if you're gonna be fighting for that person, you have to have ample ammunition. So you wanna make sure that your interview with the chair or the head goes well for one, and as well as, you know, all the other interviews. So that's a kind of a brief overview of how things run. I've been in positions where it's a summer hire and it's a small committee, and it's me and the other committee member or two or three that are making this decision and pushing that forward to the dean. So there's lots of different situations we can find ourselves in, but I think if we have proper preparation, we can have some success. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Butler. Our next presenter is Dr. Javian Brabham. And Dr. Brabham, as well as being an accomplished musician, teacher, professor, has recently been through the job search and interview process himself. So he can speak both from the perspective of a faculty member and also from the perspective of someone who's recently successfully navigated that course. So Dr. Brabham, thank you so much, and we look forward to what you can share this morning.
Thank you. Thank you, Nancy. I'm share my screen with you. If you could, oh, there it is, great. I just have a quick presentation. Luckily, there's, through our previous two speakers, you can tell that there's a lot of overlap. But I just want to share a little bit of my experience. As Ms. Nancy said, I've recently gone through the search process and been very fortunate to have success going through that process. But I want to just talk about a few of the things that I did to prepare for my interview, both the virtual interview as well as interviewing in person. So there's just a few things that I did. I think, you know, all potential candidates should do is something as simple as practicing interviewing. I would contact a lot of my mentors, either former teachers or friends of mine who are in higher ed positions, and I would practice questions. There's, you know, for every job interview, there's going to be pretty much the same questions, more so. So practicing those questions and doing a lot of mock interviews with people you trust, mentors, former teachers, or colleagues, if you're at another institution, that can be very, very valuable. And by practicing those questions, it kind of brings me to my next point, which is it helps you create concise answers. Someone already mentioned that all your answers need to be concise. And I, especially in your virtual interview, your interview is going to be sometimes between 15 to 20, 25 minutes. So the committee who's going to be asking you questions, they have a very limited amount of time. So you want to make sure that what they ask you, that your answers are concise, they're to the point, and you're able to talk about your teaching philosophies, your process in a very step-by-step process. I believe this, and this is how I will accomplish this in a kind of step-by-step process. And that shows that your beliefs are well thought out and that the committee, they can hear what you're saying and see it play out so they can make that connection with you. And then another very quick thing is, again, to kind of continue on this, having concise answers is you want to look at these different type of questions, like why do you want this position? Have a very concise question answer about that. You know, why this certain institution that you're applying for? Why are you interested in that institution? What about that institution is excites you to hopefully one day work at that institution? You know, be able to talk about your teaching experience in a very concise way. And telling the committee a little bit about yourself, if you have time to, you know, have that kind of personal conversation with your committee. And then next, I think it's also good to do some homework about the institution that you're applying for. You know, where is it? Is it a public university? Is it a small or large institution? Is it private? What type of students typically go to that institution? What is the school's mission? What type of resources does it have? I think all of these things will aid you in a successful interview, especially once you get to the on-campus interview, because then you can actually have a more, direct conversation to the search committee. For a virtual, I think there's a few differences clearly between the virtual interview and then the on-campus interview. One thing I like to do, every virtual interview I've had, and I've been fortunate enough to have quite a few, is I always dress the part. Even you know, for a virtual interview or a Zoom interview, you know, I wear the whole suit, tie, pants, shoes, because I want to create the feeling like I'm in a professional interview. I'm here to quote unquote win the job. So I want to portray that by making sure I'm fully dressed and ready and prepared for that interview. I want to make sure wherever I'm doing my virtual interview that I'm in a quiet space that could be in your home, in your home office, or if you have another office, somewhere quiet that you know that whatever happens, your surroundings are going to be very professional. And then you want to make sure that your surroundings on your camera looks clean, right? So a lot of times, you know, if you're doing a virtual interview, you can have stuff like all around you, or it could be the room could look untidy, even though the committee may not say anything about it, but little things like that, either consciously or subconsciously, I think affects a committee's opinion of you. Because you remember, you're making your first impression in your virtual interview. So you want to look as professional and as clean as possible. And then making sure that you surround yourself. You know, one thing I've always done is, you know, I surround myself with little notes in my virtual interview. They're not like answers to questions, but I use like maybe one word or single words that, you know, are like triggers for me. So if I get a question about research, I may have on my notes one or two words just to trigger my memory in real time. And then in the in-person interview, again, you want to dress professionally. These are all obviously things we know. You want to be flexible. The on-campus interview is a very long day. Sometimes it can be from 8 until 6. And if you typically there's dinner after the interview, so it could literally be a 12-hour day where you start, they pick you up from your hotel at 8 o'clock in the morning, and then you go all the way to dinner, which can go until 8 or 9. So you want to be very flexible. You want to be alert throughout the day, especially starting early in the morning, because again, it's going to be a long day. So you want to be alert and basically ready for anything. And then you want to display your passion and your for your teaching and your research. The committee is going to pick up on that. If you're really passionate about the things that you believe in and the approach you want to bring to the institution, they're going to buy that and they're going to want to hire you. And then the last thing is be personable. The committee, not only are they hiring someone to teach the students that they interact, they're hiring someone who's going to be their colleague, someone they're going to have to work with and see every day. So they want to work with somebody that's hopefully down the line becomes not just a colleague, but a friend. I've been fortunate enough to serve on a few search committees now in my position. And that is something me personally that I look for. You know, I want someone who's going to be a good person, a good colleague, someone I can, you know, feel very comfortable with. And then there's this resource for those who are in the chat. It's called Preparing Academic Interviews, Screening for Conferences and On Campus. This is, I think, a really good resource, and you know, we can certainly share this with you, by Dana Hull. She's associate director at UPenn. And this is a really great resource, and she talks about more in detail about different things and different ways to approach the interview and preparing for the interview. So that's all I have. So we'll have certainly time for more questions. And I can talk a little more directly about, you know, some of my experiences with interviews as well.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Brabham. And again, very, very important. And I love what you're saying about collegiality. And this ties in with what Dr. Captain said at the beginning about avoid the I, me, my. From everything, and this would be another webinar, but from everything from your cover letter to your interviews and all your communication, it's really not as much about you as it's about what you can do to help support that faculty, that program, and to be a citizen of that music department. So wonderful, wonderful advice. We really want the bulk of this session to be interactive. So if you will please start posing your questions in chat. Our entire panel and our co-chair for the committee, Dr. Miller, will be available to address your questions and give you some different perspectives. So we're turning this over to you. You're in charge now. So let us know what you want to know.
So I see some questions coming in. There's quite a long one. I'll get to that next. But the first question is, could you give examples of what one says if it is not I or me? And maybe Nancy, if you could expand on that, but I think other panelists may have some perspectives.
Yes. Language could be, your program is so exciting. In particular, and I'm a music ed person, so I'd say in particular, I see you have ORF workshops in the summer. I've got training in that. And so, but instead of saying I, my, me, say your program, do your homework. Study their website, see what the strengths or weaknesses are. But if you just think about it, you could turn it around instead of saying, I, my, me, say, your program is so exciting. I saw this on your website, looks great. Make it about them more than about you.
Another question, how important is it to have a completed doctorate to begin an academic position? I've gotten lots of rejections so far. Am I passed by because I'm not finished yet? Any comments from,
It's not a deal breaker. We have some people that started here and finished, within a year. Some places won't let you in the door, but there are places where they'll give you, until you're going up for tenure, even that long to complete it.
Can I add on to that? So 2 years I was on a search committee, and we were hiring a two professor, and all of our candidates, all of our finalists, all had doctorates except for one. And the person who ended up winning the job was the guy without a doctorate. And that was more because of he had very concise answers. He had a true vision of what he wanted. And it was very clear that everything was well thought out, that even though he didn't have, he didn't have his doctorate, he was in the process of finishing it. But it was very clear, like, this is the guy we definitely want. So it's definitely possible. I think the level of preparation maybe have to be even more so, because you don't have that paper, quote unquote, to rely on. So yeah, it's certainly possible.
Another thing that gets into that is whether it's a required versus a desired characteristic. If it states that a doctorate is required, then there even begin to be legal issues if a faculty hires someone who doesn't meet the posted requirements. And our dean might be able to speak more to that, but that can be an important consideration.
Yeah, I think, something that we use a lot in my current position, I'll give a great example. We have a faculty member, the only degree they have is a history degree from a well-known Ivy League college, starts with an H, but their career was in film and television. Empire Strikes Back, Dexter, Weeds, and so on and so on. And then recommendation letters from Academy Award winners made us look over the master's degree or doctoral thing to have someone that really had worldwide international accomplishment. And I think, we're in the higher learning consortium, or we're in the, I've been in the SACs, and I'm in the one now that accredits many of the institutions in the West, and they have a term called tested experience. And so when we go through our reaccreditation, our faculty who don't have a degree or have a degree in another area or something, we list their tested experience that got them the job.
Here's a question. Do you have any specific advice about applying to adjunct positions?
I've applied to some adjunct positions before. I was hired to do an adjunct position, but then ended up taking another position because it was full time. I treat the adjunct interviews and that process just as if it was a tenure track. I think if you do that and treat it as such and prepare it as such, then you will have success, because it's the same thing, although it's an adjunct position. But if you prepare and you have concise answers again, I think that's certainly the best way to go about it. Yeah.
That's great. Javian, I wonder if you might comment on this next one also. This is, and maybe somebody else will say, have things to add. When should you follow up after a Zoom interview? As we were having this hearing from the panelists, I was reflecting on how much the interview landscape has changed just in these last few years with the advent of virtual interviews. We had phone interviews in the past and maybe a teleconference, but it was nothing like what we can do now. So you want to comment a bit about that? What do you think about follow-up?
Typically, at least recently, at the end of the interview, the Zoom interview, typically one of the questions I would ask, like, that find out what their timeline is, because typically they have a number of candidates that they're still going to interview. So you can either be at the beginning of that or you can be at the end. And typically they'll let you know, so like, we, you know, we're going through this process. We have a few more candidates to interview. We'll let you know in the next week or two. So typically they'll give you a timeline of when that is. And so if they say it's going to be 2 weeks and you haven't heard, maybe then that's the time to maybe reach out. Or sometimes that could be an indicator that maybe, unfortunately, you didn't make the next round of interviews. But usually if they are going to be later than they tell you, they'll send you an email and reach out, say, you know, you're still in running. We're just running behind. We're waiting to get approval for something, which is, you know, stuff that are outside of their control. Maybe they have to wait on their provost to give them a special permission to, you know, invite you for the on-campus round of the interviews.
Typically, it has to go from the dean to affirmative action to the provost, yeah. And all of those things can slow down the process. But it's appropriate to follow up with the committee chair. Just be careful about balancing being engaged and interested with being a pest. And that's, you know, anything can be overdone.
Nancy, if I could add on to that, it used to be always send a handwritten note. I mean, that was like everybody would do that. It's just an expectation, thanking the committee for interviewing you and so on. And that's gone by the wayside. I think I've actually heard some senior administrators say, you know, don't bother, you know, what good is that? And I interview people for a lot of different positions as a dean, you know, in technology and finance, other things for the university. And a lot of times, you know, we get an email from the person, thank you for interviewing and such. And I tell you, with everybody getting 300 emails a day, it's hard to even remember that you got that note of thank you. And so I think that, you know, I think the question was headed towards, you know, when do you check in to find out what the status is? I would say never, you know, because they're gonna tell you when they're ready. And that's excruciating, I know. And sometimes months go by and you don't hear, or, you know, you hear about someone meeting someone at an airport and they got the job that the person walking by them didn't get, but the person was never notified. So there's all those faux pas. But yeah, that's always an interesting and space that has a lot of tension associated with it a lot of times.
Here's a question about research about institutions with which you're unfamiliar. This person says, how can you effectively get a sense of the institution just from their website? I've spent hours doing research only to feel like I barely have any real understanding, especially if it's a college I've never heard of in a state that's not close by.
You know, I don't want to overtalk, and I am already, but you know, one thing that I've heard people do several times is, if you're there the night before, drop into the student cafeteria, and you know, you might be portrayed as a parent saying that you're scoping out the campus and see what the students have to say, and then find a way to put that in with your interview, because that shows initiative. You know, it's not creepy, like, you know, you came the week before or something, but if there's a way you can say, you know, I was really inspired, you know, I just happened to meet this student and they said X, 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 and that's the kind of place I wanna be.
And I'd like to say something about this too, that if you do research in every way you can, you might not be able to find everything. This is perhaps where the area where they say, do you have any questions for us? And always have some good questions. And going back to what Dr. Captain said initially about culture, ask some questions about the culture there. What are, can you describe, you know, successful traits of faculty members here? Can you describe your most successful students? And sometimes you can get some really good conversations going within that panel that will let you know a little bit about what that culture is there and give you some more of that research right on the spot.
Yeah. And I would add, I had this exact same experience. My first job that I got hired for was this small, very small liberal arts college in the mountains of North Georgia. I'd never heard of it. No one that I knew had ever heard of it. So what I did is I went on their website. I did all as much research about the school as I could. And then I did something as simple as go on YouTube and watch like recruiting videos, watch different videos of their ensembles, just to kind of get a feel of what their environment is, what it looks like, what type of students they have. Things that's as simple as that, I think, was really helpful for me, knowing what I was kind of walking into and what type of people were there.
Isrea, it looks like you've got a comment on this.
I like what Michael said about asking questions. I don't always ask enough, but we missed a question and somebody called us on it. Alejandro's question was one of the first ones.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, he said, do you not feel that searches in American academia, let's talk music specifically, have taken a strong credentialistic angle, prioritizing candidates with degrees from institutions considered for good or bad reasons, prestigious, having a commanding brand over on the job achievements, hands-on learning, record of program or studio building, and other forms of after college non-credentialed grow as a musician and educator. Isn't music academia privileging brand over real life experience and continuous education?
Do you want to answer that, Isrea?
No, but I will. in some instances, yes, the degree is a requirement for tenure. So we can't hire someone to be an assistant professor rank if that's the line that we're available. If it's a different line, a lecturer or instructor line, we might be able to change those. Or if it's a specialty where it's going to be really hard to find somebody with a DMA in jazz, for instance, then we might require the master's with significant experience. It depends on what the line is, the line you're able to offer to have in the department. Obviously, you can't just look at somebody's degree and say, oh, well, they went to X, so they must be good. But you know, the reason why we spend the bucks to go to those schools is because they have a reputation of producing excellent musicians. It's a balancing act. And that's up to the committee to really look into all the qualifications, listen to the recordings, and research those candidates.
Pedigree is important. We can't deny that. There are certainly prestige associated with certain institutions, and that's because they are fine institutions and have a track record of producing outstanding graduates. But your own accomplishments and emerging national reputation as a scholar, as a performer, as an educator is most important, because they're not hiring your alma mater, they're hiring you. So it's very, very important to make sure that as a student, you're depending upon your discipline, you're performing, you're publishing, you're participating in national level high impact types of professional activities. And that can get you hired regardless of where your degree is from.
It seems that there is a move as we're looking toward more and more egalitarian means of screening candidates. There is certainly conversation about removing some of those the brandings that occur toward a first cut from that first set of screenings. So, for instance, a CV would be redacted to indicate that the person had the degree, but not necessarily the institution where it's from, as a first in a first round. And I don't believe it's happening yet. Certainly not very universally, but I could imagine us moving toward that. Similar to the way that we've moved toward auditions behind a screen for performing organizations, a similar kind of process. There's a question about the first cut that which is relates to this. Simply, can you tell us a little bit more about making the first cut? I want to take the opportunity to answer, give my answer, which could, because this came up a lot in my conversations with graduate students in my past jobs. And unfortunately, I think a lot of us, when we apply for jobs, think that the review committee will spend a lot of time with our materials as we present them. And the reality is, in the first cut, they want to, the committee wants to spend as little time as possible with it, because they've got a stack of 100 to get through in order to get down to 5 or 10 that will take absolutely give the most serious attention to. So the reality is, at least my experience as a search committee member, and then in other situations, is that the first time through, I'm looking for a reason to throw someone's materials off the pile. That's a really harsh reality, but I think it's true. If I've got 100, I need to get down to 10. I'm looking for 9 out of 10 as for something to, a reason to throw it off the pile. So that speaks to the, you know, the perfection that Javian and Isrea were talking about in terms of the materials you develop. Yes. If you've got typos in your cover letter, you will not make the cut. Simple as that. So I really recommend that those outside reviewing, that outside reviewing of your materials before you send them off. Other thoughts about making the first cut from colleagues?
Right. Well, actually, that's a topic for an entirely separate webinar in terms of preparing your dossier, convincing cover letter, convincing CVs. That's a topic that could be very appropriate for a future webinar. But yes, very, very important to understand that process. And just real quickly, because that is a whole other topic, you need to prepare a separate cover letter and even cut and paste and organize your CV specifically for each vacancy for which you are applying. And again, that if at the end, we're going to ask you to suggest topics for future webinars. So if you like the idea of spending an hour just working on that, let us know. And we'll try to provide that in the future.
Yeah, Nancy, I think that's a really good point. A pet peeve I had as a reviewer of materials is if you asked for something very specific in the job description, and the person's that answer to that question was buried in the last pages of someone's CV, I interpreted that as they really didn't know what we were looking for and they didn't pay attention to our job ad. So yeah, arrange your CV to line up with what the job announcement says.
Dr. Miller?
Yes, I'd speak to what you've just been saying, and that is customization of your application to that organization, both in what you send them and the way you're talking to them. It is about your fit with them. They are looking for somebody to meet their needs. You know, it's not your needs that is the first order of business for them. So make sure that you are addressing what's in their materials, what's in their search, that you're using their language, and your goal is to be a good fit with them as a fellow colleague. Because if they let you in, they might be looking at you for years in these committee meetings. So do you want to be in the same room with them for years? And that's what they're thinking about. And I will add that we do have, I'll put in a plug for our committee's mentoring program through CMS. And so there is a lot, you can go online and you can get a session with one of our mentors from our Career Development and Entrepreneurship Committee. So I'd advise everybody to take that resource that CMS offers.
And during our conferences, you can sign up for a face-to-face mentoring session with a member of our committee. So there are lots of perks for CMS members in terms of career counseling.
Great. A number of people have asked about the materials from this webinar in terms of PowerPoint slides and websites. We won't send those out, but I just want to remind people this will be recorded and will be posted in the CMS library so people can refer back to it and pull those materials off the site. Here's a question. In your experience on search committees, how much is previous teaching experience valued?
Previous college teaching is a definite plus. if you've been if you've been a GTA or if you've served as an adjunct, but previous college teaching typically is an asset. If we've got two people with the same qualifications, same credentials, one person has some college teaching experience, the other one doesn't, that person has an edge.
Great. I bet that I'm seeing nods from other colleagues. Here's another question. Can you offer some do's and don'ts for the question, describe a difficult situation you faced and how you addressed it? A very common question. And I think if you could respond to that, maybe some best cases you've experienced and some worst cases you've experienced of that question or thoughts you have.
This is not a therapy session. Don't divulge some deep, dark, personal thing. Turn lemons into lemonade. Talk about something that was challenging and then describe ways that you are trying to overcome that. A very typical question is to talk about your weakness. You know, what do you perceive as your greatest strength as a faculty member? What do you perceive as your greatest weakness? But be positive. For example, I might say a weakness is that I don't know enough about current technology, current instructional technology, but this is what I'm doing to improve that. So be sure if you describe a weakness, talk about something productive that you're doing to shore that up. Be careful about, be honest, don't appear too arrogant or too saccharine, be very genuine, but also think about something that's going to have a professional positive spin. At least that's my suggestion. We'll see what others say.
I'd say find something where you had a problem and you succeeded, or you are in the middle of growth and how you grew from that, so that it's a downer just talking about it.
Here's some specific questions. It's kind of funny to think about it, but I think it's very important. Can you share details on the dinner part of the interview? What's order, splitting the bill? What's the proper etiquette in a search committee dinner? And I know that they vary from institution to institution in terms of their policies, but some thoughts, colleagues.
Have a granola bar. You'll be talking more than eating and eat that in some private moment. You won't get to eat much during the dinner.
Isrea, did you have something?
I was saying don't order drinks unless they order drinks. Usually, someone asks if you have to pay for it. Usually they cover it or you'll be reimbursed. You don't have to, you know, pay for someone else. And you have match what is going on with the situation. So if it's more relaxed, then you can be a little more relaxed, but you're still being interviewed. So don't get hammered.
You know, Nancy said exactly what I was going to say is I always take some energy bars or granola bars, and I've done this for a long time. And this sounds bad, but you know, when you in the restroom, you can find a little corner or something, eat your energy bar. And then I just pick at lunch and dinner because, you know, if someone asks you a question and you're chewing on something, or I mean, it's very healthy to kind of eat away from. And they say, well, aren't you hungry? You say, you know, I've been nibbling all day, and right now I want to give you my full attention. And yeah, and drinking too, I'm careful with that. Anything can throw things off. People are watching it from every angle.
That can give you a different response, you know, from the drinking, or just the impression that you're giving, you know, if you are drinking, because you don't know who doesn't like that. And I would add, don't order anything messy. Make sure that whatever you're eating is not going to end up on you. And you can watch who's doing the most talking by how much food is on different people's plates, including your own. Can kind of measure how things are going with that.
This may sound silly, but video yourself eating and watch it and see what impression you make. A lot of us, especially when we're students, professors, We eat while we're reading, we eat while we're grading papers, and we can develop some pretty casual eating habits. So I'm really sincere, videotape yourself eating and self-critique and kind of think about maybe there are some behaviors you might want to alter or adapt for that particular situation when you're being observed very closely.
If I could add on to what Nancy just said too, I think a favorite thing I know some people do is order a big dinner, pick a little bit at it, and then ask for it to go box. And then you've kind of covered everything. It doesn't seem like you're, you know, because people have empathy a lot of times. They're going to worry, well, gee, they're not eating. What's going on here? And say, you know, I want to spend my time with you, and I'm going to take this back to my room and finish it there. And then you kind of cover the bases of, you know, accepting hospitality, but at the same time, not, you know, chewing while you're trying to talk.
Folks, we are unfortunately getting close to the end of the time, and there are many, many questions. What I will say is that we'll save all of the questions. There's time for a couple more, but we'll save all of the questions, and we will find a way to post some answers to those. I'll speak with my colleagues with the committee to make sure we respond to them. There are a number of topics that are coming up that I think suggest future webinars. For instance, applying for jobs. If I've been a faculty member at one kind of institution, moving to a different kind of institution, or moving from faculty positions to administrative positions. So I think we've got some really rich conversations for next webinars. And again, if people want the materials from this, I would recommend that people find this on posting it in our archive on the CMS library, and so people can review this again.
Bill, I don't think, can you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
Before we break up, our committee would like to invite people to text and chat, not question and answer, but in chat. We've got two questions we'd like feedback on for future planning. The first question is, what did you find most useful about this session? And the second question is, what topics would you like to see on future sessions? If you would be so kind as to put that in chat, our committee will save that, review your comments, and use that for future planning. And I was trying to share my screen, but it locked up, Bobby. But I'll see if I can put those two questions.
Feedback on this, what was useful, what was most useful about this, and then future topics from the Committee on Career Development and Entrepreneurship, perhaps specifically related to interviewing or positions, but other topics as well.
I think I'm sharing now, if you can see the questions.
Yeah, we see that now.
Perfect. Thank you. I'm sorry I'm having some technology issues here.
And these webinars can be on academic careers. They can also be in careers in any area of the of music careers. So we love to hear your feedback.
Here's another plug for the mentoring program. One of our listeners says, I cannot speak highly enough about the mentoring program. I've used it several times at different points in my career to address very specific questions. For example, this is where I'm stuck professionally right now, and I could use advice about next steps. And I want to echo that. Our colleagues in CMS are eager to help. You can see, I mean, Nancy and Michael and our panelists, this is just a quick slice of the people in CMS who would be very eager to assist in your career development. So please do use our resources to your advantage.
There's a question on where to find that. It's on the CMS website, music.org, and you go to, I believe, careers and find a mentor, and you can find it right through there.
Yeah, so music.org again. So colleagues, I think we're Nancy, do you have a wrap up for us? And then I have a quick one as well.
Oh, okay. Again, I just want to thank our panel so very much for taking time out to participate and their generous sharing of these important ideas. Thank you, Bill, and our CMS leadership for allowing us to do this and supporting this. And most of all, thank you, participants, for wonderful questions. I'm sorry we didn't have time to cover everyone's questions, but thank you so much for your questions. I hope you found this helpful, and I'm seeing lots of suggestions coming in for future webinars, so hope we'll see some of you in the future as well. Thank you so much, Dr. Pelto.
Yes. To our attendees, I hope you've enjoyed this presentation from the College Music Society. You found it professionally informative, no doubt. Please know that it will be formatted for posting in the online CMS library for later viewing. Please consider returning for future webinars and presentations from CMS, including our next session presented by the CMS Committee on Musicians' Health on February 25th. That will feature Dr. Christine Guptill, who will discuss an online curriculum for student musicians' health developed by colleagues in Australia and piloted by three Canadian universities. And now on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Nancy Berry and the members of the CMS Committee on Career Development and Entrepreneurship, including co-chair Michael Miller, who has been with us today, our panelists Javian Brabham, Isrea Butler, and Lawrence Captain, and especially to all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weeks. I hope to see you back here later this month.